But even different times throughout our daily lives, really. Granted, you know, most people think of silence as being a virtue just for religious to practice. But indeed, you know, religious will be held more accountable for their practice of silence or lack thereof. But well, silence is a great means of acquiring a spirit of prayer and disposing the soul to converse continually with God. God's not going to be talking to us if we're listening to rock music or the TV or the computer. Seems like you can't go anywhere without them playing music. And, you know, like in the stores years ago, it was like elevator music almost. At least today, it's just noise pollution. So we should all desire to want to dispose our soul to converse continually with God. And that's why we need silence. We rarely find a spiritual soul that speaks continuously. You know, all souls of prayer are lovers of silence. I think you need to bolt this thing down, at least for me. you know, that's why it's called the guardian of innocence, the shield against temptations, the fountain of prayer. Because by silence, devotion is preserved. And I'm sure you've experienced this in some parish churches. You go there, you get there early for Mass to recollect yourself, to place yourself in the presence of God. And it sounds like a school cafeteria. It's just very distracting. I was talking to someone the other day, and it says, whenever they go to the cry room. They're always in the cry room when they're at church, because it's the quietest place in the church. They don't have any children, but they're always in the cry room. Or, you know, after Mass, you try to give a Thanksgiving, and it's just, you can't do it. So, by silence, devotion's preserved. You know, it's good thoughts spring up. St. Bernard says, silence and the absence of noise in a certain manner force the soul to think of God and eternal goods. And it's sad. I met a former MIM member. She avoided retreats like the plague because they were silent. And it forced herself to look at herself, and she didn't want to do that. It's not pretty. You know, we don't want to examine our conscience. People don't want to go to confession. Who wants to remember our bad choices? But, you know, I mean, the saints, they would flee to the mountains, to caves, to deserts, just to get away from the noise, to find silence. And some of them observed silence for, you know, 30, 40 years or more. One saint, St. John the Silent, he was surnamed, gave up his bishopric to become a monk and observe silence for 47 years before his death. And all the saints, you know, even those who were not hermits were lovers of silence. They realized how great the blessings that silence brings to the soul. The prophet Isaiah says that silence shall cultivate justice in the soul. For on the one hand, it saves us from many sins by destroying the roots of arguments. There's never an argument where there's silence. There's never detraction or resentment or curiosity that, these lead to gossip. On the other hand, the silence, it makes us acquire many virtues, just those virtues of not committing those sins. If we practice humility, when we let others do all the talking, that's a way to grow in that humility, that virtue. And it's a great mortification not to, or by not yielding to an inclination or a desire, to tell a certain antidote or use some witty expression suggested by the conversation. And we practice heroic meekness by remaining silent when we are unjustly criticized or offended. But on the other hand, immense evils flow from speaking too much. In the first place, devotion is preserved by silence, so it is lost by too much talking. However recollected the soul may be or may have been in prayer, if it afterwards indulges in long conversations, it will find the mind distracted and dissipated, as if it had not prayed at all. If afterwards it indulges in that conversation, but the Holy Spirit tells us in the book of Proverbs that in speaking too much, we shall not fail to commit some fault while they speak and prolong conversation without necessity. Certain people think that they're not guilty of any defect, but if they carefully examine themselves, they'll find some fault, against modesty, detraction, curiosity, or at least just superfluous words. St. Mary Magdalene de Pazzi used to say that a religious should speak only through necessity, but actually, everyone really should consider this advice. Jesus himself told us in the Gospel of Matthew. But I say to you that every idle word that men speak, they shall account for it in the day of judgment. St. James talks about the tongue in his epistle. Says it's a world of iniquity. For as a learned author remarks, you know, the greater number of sins arise from speaking or listening to others. You know, I have to admit that a lot of what we'll be saying is, from this point forward, is really intended for religious. But you could very well benefit for, since you are secular, religious, living in the world, you know. So you can apply it and put it into practice in your own life. St. Alphonsus de Liguori wrote, you know, how many nuns shall we see condemned on the day of judgment on account of having had little regard for silence? And what is most to be deplored is that the religious that disputes in our mind by excessive contact with creatures and by speaking too much will never be able to avoid, you know, defects. So it goes back to just what we were saying earlier about avoiding all the unnecessary talk about others in gossiping. And St. Ignatius Loyola said, if you want to know if there is fervor in a convent, all you have to do is see if silence is observed or not. Even our Lord speaks about silence to St. Faustina in her diary, and how important it is. You know, since we're getting a late start, I may have to omit some of this, since a lot of it is for religious, but it's also interesting. You've, like, had a lot of holy founders of religious orders that have prescribed in their constitutions about the necessity of silence to their religious, because they just knew how important its observance is for fervor and that spirit of devotion. St. Basil insists on it in his rule for nuns, not once, but, you know, frequently. St. Benedict commanded his monks to observe continual silence, you know, just necessary speaking, not unnecessary speaking. And we could all be a lot more productive if we didn't talk so much, you know. That's ora et labora. That's what his rule was. So experience shows that monastery where silence is observed, discipline is maintained, and where silence is neglected, little fervor is found. So, you know, few religious become saints because few love silence. In many monasteries, the rule of silence is prescribed by written rules, and it's strongly recommended. But some of the religious do not seem to know what silence is. This was a case in St. Margaret of Castello. At one time in her life, she joined an order of nuns, and they weren't observing silence, and she wanted to observe the rule as best she could. And all the nuns said, oh, she's not being, they interpreted her as not being very friendly and avoiding conversation, and it's just not one of the gang. And so the Mother Superior said, well, if you don't conform, you'll have to leave. So she had to leave just because they weren't observing their... She wanted to live the rule and they didn't. So it's just mediocrity. A lot of people are happy with their mediocre spirituality. They don't want to put forth too much effort. It's too uncomfortable. Going back to the homily about that mortification and death to self, that can get old. And once you start, it's like you get these thoughts, and it's maybe I could give this up because you're making this sacrifice and that sacrifice. And then it just seems to never stop. And it's like the temptation is just to say enough. But we can't, we can never give in. Because we know God loves a generous giver. So that's why sometimes you're tempted to think, well, is that something I'm coming up with? Or is that from God? Well, St. Paul says, any good that we do is from God. The only thing that's from us is our sins. So, and silence is one of those little mortifications that is very neglected these days. So just during these precious few days that you have of retreat, to observe silence, endeavor to practice it as much as possible if you wish to keep yourself recollected with God. People say, wouldn't it be nice if God told you what to do? Or, how can he get a word in edgewise if there's constant noise? God speaks to us in silence. So, if you wish to keep yourself recollected and free from distractions, observe silence. And if you cannot do it for your own benefit, for the love of God, the supernatural charity, at least try for the sake of your fellow retreatants. And it's going to be the hardest for me because it's been years since I've seen you, and I'd love to sit down at a meal and carry on a conversation. But we'll let Bishop Sheen do the talking during the meals. So it's a sacrifice. So I have to practice what I preach, as hard as it may be. Although I'm not on retreat, but for your sake, I'll try not to disturb your silence. So, St. John Chrysostom would say, why should we speak when it is more useful, to be silent? I mean, the only time we should speak is if it's going to be more useful. They say silence is golden, you know, except when it's yellow. Sometimes we remain silent when we shouldn't remain silent. If the truth is being attacked, we have to speak. Because if the truth is being attacked, Christ is being attacked. Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life. You know, the truth just isn't something, it's someone. So there are times that we do have to speak. So St. John Chrysostom would say, either remain silent or say what is more profitable than silence. So there can be rapid progress in divine love through the practice of silence. Before speaking, you know, we should consider whether what we intend to say could injure charity or modesty or someone's character. And, you know, even if it's true, it doesn't need to be said. That's called detraction. You know, just, you don't have to broadcast people's sins. St. Paul says, only the good things people need to hear. Things that are going to help them. Like I said earlier, you know, we need to be that light, a source of hope and encouragement to others. Not building up the kingdom, not tearing people down. You know, our sins tear at the fabric of the mystical body of Christ. People say, I'm not hurting anyone. Yes, there are people dying in wars on the other side of the planet because of our detraction, our sins. Our Lady of Fatima said, war is a punishment for sin. So, and we're all sinners, so we do hurt others. Now, examine the motive that impels your speech. For, you know, it sometimes happens that what a person says is good, but their intentions may be bad. They speak either to appear spiritual, or, you know, to acquire a reputation, you know, for talent to impress others. They examine to whom we speak. Whether, is it someone in authority? Or, you know, either ecclesiastical or civil, or an employee or employer, to companions, or, you know, to inferiors. Also, whether it's if it's in the presence of others who may be scandalized, you know, by what we say. But I think if someone's going to be scandalized, but we say we shouldn't say it. Sometimes you have to talk about important matters, or if there's something that needs to be corrected and that's going on, well, you know, you don't need to let others hear that conversation. We just must never forget, you know, the importance of our good example. And that's why we have to be those lights shining in the darkness. Recreation is needed. It's always a proper time for relaxation. But, you know, we can endeavor as often as possible to speak of something that has a reference to God. You know, let us speak of the Lord Jesus, St. Ambrose says, who has an ardent love for another, is always speaking about them. They who speak little of Jesus show that they have but little love for Jesus. On the other hand, you know, if it happens that good people, after speaking on divine love, feel more fervor than after mental prayer, they have to examine their devotion, and just because, you know, our prayer, our devotions, they're all means to an end. They're not an end in themselves. At the conversation of the servants of God, says Saint Teresa of Jesus, Jesus is always present, and concerning this Father Gisolfo of the Congregation of Pious Workers relates a memorable example in the life of the Venerable Father Anthony de Colelas. He says that Father Constantine Rossi, the master of novices, saw one day two of his young disciples conversing together, and with them a resplendent young man. And the master of novices was surprised that these two novices, whom he regarded as most exemplary, should speak to a stranger, you know, without permission. He therefore asked, you know, who was the young man whom he had seen conversing with them? And I said, there wasn't anyone else conversing with them. And afterwards he learned that they were speaking of Jesus Christ, and he understood that the person whom he saw in their company was their Savior. So except for in the hours of recreation and other extraordinary occasions, you know, such as attending the sick or in consoling someone in tribulation, it's always better to be silent. I mean, you're not monks and you haven't taken a vow of silence or anything, but we'd be amazed at how many unnecessary things we say throughout the day. A religious in the Order of St. Teresa said that it's better to speak with God than to speak of God. But when obedience or charity obliges you to speak or to have contact with others, you must always endeavor to find some quiet time. So just let us remember that the time given us is not to be spent unprofitably, you know, with useless chatter. It's to be employed for God, and it's to be used for acquiring merits for eternity, and we'll be talking about that in our next conference. So, as hard as it may be, we'll try to do our best to have a silent retreat and have that time to reflect, you know, to come up with a battle plan, because we are all at war, whether we want to be or not. You notice the theme of the retreat, spiritual weapons for spiritual warfare, and silence is one of those weapons, you know. So let us ask Our Lady to help us be silent so that we can reflect on our battle plan for reentering the battleground. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Our Lady, Mother of the Redeemer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Praise be Jesus and Mary. This morning you heard from Bishop Sheen at this conference, and a lot of my material I get from St. Alphonsus de Liguori. And this conference is going to be on wasting time. And you think, well, wasting time is not a spiritual weapon, but it is. It's a spiritual weapon of the enemy. And St. Alphonsus reminds us that there is nothing that is shorter than time. There is nothing that is more valuable than time. It's the most precious commodity on the face of the earth. And it's held in such little esteem, you know. He says there's nothing shorter than time because the past is no more. The future's uncertain. And the present is but a fleeting moment. And he said that's what Jesus meant when he said, you know, a little while now you shall not see me. And we may, at the same time, read in the epistle of St. James, you know, that life's just a vapor that soon scattered, you know, dissipated forever. we know life is just as precious as it is short. For in every moment, you know, if spent well, we can store up treasures, and you know, we have each moment of each day to do that. But if we use our time poorly, you know, we may end up in hell. So today, I want to remind you how precious every moment of time is that God gives us, and that we really cannot waste it, much less commit sin with our time, you know, but to let us perform good works for the salvation of souls and the glory of God. The Lord says, in an acceptable time, I have heard thee, and in the day of salvation, I have helped thee. St. Paul explains this passage and says that the acceptable time is the time which God determined to confer his favors on us. Then he adds, behold, now is the acceptable time. Now is the day of salvation. You know, he exhorts us to not spend our time unprofitably. And he calls this day the day of salvation because, you know, perhaps after this day there shall be no salvation for us. The time, he says, is short. It remains that we weep as though we were not weeping, and that we rejoice as if we weren't rejoicing. And they that buy as though they possessed not, and they that use this world as though they used it not. The apostle says, tells those who weep that they ought not to weep because the sorrows shall soon pass away, and that those rejoice that they not be caught up or fix their affections on their enjoyments, because they shall soon have an end. So he concludes that we should use the world not to enjoy its transitory goods, but to merit eternal life. You know, this life is just a preparation period for a life to come. And in the book of Ecclesiastes, we read, son, observe the time. Son, learn to preserve the time, which is the most precious and greatest gift that God can bestow upon you. Saint Bernardine of Siena teaches that time is as much value as God, because in every moment of time well spent, the possession of God is merited. He adds that in every instant of this life, a man may obtain the pardon for his sins, the grace of God, and the glory of paradise. That's why St. Bonaventure says, no loss is of greater moment than the loss of time. In another place he says that though there's nothing more precious than time, there's nothing less valuable in the estimation of men. You know, like I said, they waste it, or they kill time. That's exactly what they do. You'll see some people spending hours on end at play or in front of the TV or on their computer or phone. If you ask them why they waste so much time, they answer, well, you know, to amuse myself. Others remain half the day, you know, standing in the street or looking out from a window, and you ask them what they're doing, and they'll reply that oh, they're just passing the time, killing time. And, you know, they got that right. And when you kill time, it's dead. Good for nothing. Except for we will have to answer for the time we waste. We should use it to motivate us, the time we wasted, to do penance and to make reparation. And Saint Bernardine says, do you waste time? You know, why should you let a single hour, which the mercy of God gives you to weep for your sins and to acquire divine grace, pass? Saint Alphonsus says, oh, time despised by men during life, how much shall you be desired at the moment of death? And particularly in the other world, time is a blessing which we enjoy only in this life. It's not enjoyed in the next. It's not found in heaven or hell. The damned cry out with tears, oh, that an hour were given to us, that, you know, they would pay the price, any price, for an hour or even a minute, in which they might undo their eternal ruin. But this hour or minute they shall never have. Of course, in heaven there's no weeping, but if the saints were capable of sorrow, all their wailing would arise from the thought of having lost in this life the time which they could have acquired greater glory for God, and from the conviction that this time shall never be given them, they would weep. But a deceased Benedictine nun appeared in glory to a certain person and said that she was in heaven and in the enjoyment of perfect happiness, but that you know, if she could desire anything, it would be to return to this life and suffer affliction in order to merit an increase in glory. And she added that to acquire the glory which would correspond to a single Ave Maria, she would be content to suffer till the day of judgment the long and painful sickness which brought her to her death. And St. Teresa of Avila, I heard, said the same thing. She appeared in glory to one of her nuns and said the same thing. St. Francis Borgia was careful to use every moment of time for God. And when others spoke of useless things, he conversed with God in prayer and holy affections. And one day he was so recollected that when asked his opinion on the subject of the conversation. He didn't know what to answer. And being corrected for this, he said, "You know, I'm content to be considered stupid rather than to waste my time on vanities." Someone may ask, "Well, yeah, what evil am I doing?" And a philosopher will tell you that, you know, evil is an absence of good. So, is it not an evil to spend time in useless occupations, which are unprofitable for the soul? You know, does God give us our time to waste it on the day of judgment, or Lord will demand an account, not only for every month or day that has been lost, but even for every idle word we read in the Gospel of St. Matthew. He shall likewise demand an account for every moment of time which is wasted. According to St. Bernard, all time which is not spent for God is lost time. And what we can do today, don't put off till tomorrow, because tomorrow, well, we may be dead and gone into eternity. We'll be out of time, outside of time. Where shall we shall have no more time to do good, and where we shall only enjoy the reward of our virtues or suffer the punishment due to our sins. Today, if you hear the voice of the Lord, harden not your hearts. God calls us to confess our sins, to restore ill-gotten goods, to be reconciled with our enemies. We must obey his call today, because our time may be up tomorrow. Or, you know, God may just stop calling. All our salvation depends on corresponding with the inspirations we receive from the Holy Spirit at the time that God gives them. Some people say, "I'm young. After some time, I'll give myself to God." But, you know, remember that the gospel tells us, you know, Jesus cursed the fig tree, which he found without fruit. Although, you know, the season for figs had not even arrived yet. And by this, our Lord wished to signify that man, at all times, even in youth, should produce fruits of good works. Otherwise, like the fig tree, he shall be cursed. In Ecclesiastes, we read, "Delay not to be converted to the Lord, and defer it not from day to day, for his wrath shall come." You know, if you find your soul in the state of sin, don't delay your repentance or confession. Don't even put it off till tomorrow. Or, you know, if you don't obey the voice of God calling you today to confess your sins, death may overtake you, and therefore lose no time. St. John writes in the book of Revelation, the devil is come down unto you having great wrath, knowing that he hath but a short time. He never wastes any time in seeking to drag us into hell. Therefore, we should never squander the time which God has given us to save our souls. And for those who say, I will hereafter give myself to God, St. Bernard answers, how can you, a miserable sinner, presume on the future as if God, the Father, has placed time in your power? Why do you presume that you will hereafter give yourself to God as if he had given you the time and opportunity of returning to him whenever you wish? Job said with trembling that he knew not whether another moment of his life remained. And you say, I'm not going to confession today, I'll think about it tomorrow. St. Augustine says, how can you promise yourself another day when you don't even know if you'll be alive in the next hour? St. Teresa says, if you're not prepared to die today, tremble, lest you die an unhappy death. St. Bernardine of Siena wept over the blindness of those negligent Christians who squander the days of salvation and never consider that a day once lost will never return. At the hour of death, they will wish for another year or another day, but they shall not have it. They shall then be told that time shall be no more. What price would they not then give for another week, for a day, or even an hour to prepare the account which they must render to God? St. Lawrence Justinian says, for that for a single hour they would give all their property, all their honors, and all their delights. But this hour shall not be granted them. What will it profit a sinner who has led an inconsistent life to exclaim at death, if only I had led a life of sanctity and spent my years in loving God, how great the distress, of someone out in the woods hiking, and then when night's approaching, he realizes that he's taken a wrong path, and that there's no more time, to correct his mistake. Such shall be the anguish at death, of those who have lived many years in the world but have not spent them for God. In the Gospel of St. John, we read, the night has come when no man can work. Therefore, our Lord says to us all, walk while you have the light, so that the darkness may not overtake you. Walk in the way of salvation now that you have the light, before you are surprised by the darkness of death, in which you can do nothing. You can then only weep over the time which you have wasted. At the hour of death, our conscience will remind us of all the time which we had to become saints and which we instead of used in multiplying our sins against God. It will remind us of all the inspirations, all the graces which He has given to us to enable us to love Him, and which we have abused, not cooperated with, or just put off. And at that awful moment, we should also see the way of salvation is closed, you know, forever. In the midst of the sorrows and the darkness of death, the dying sinner shall say, "Oh, fool that I've been, life squandered, years wasted, in which I could have gained treasures of merit and have become a saint, but I've neglected both. And now the time of saving my soul is gone forever. You know, but there's these lamentations, you know, be of no use." When the scene of this world is about to close, and the lamp is on the point of being extinguished, and when the dying Christian has arrived at the great moment on which eternity depends. Well, now is the day of salvation, not tomorrow. Be ready, for we know not when the Son of Man will come. The Lord says, be prepared. He doesn't tell us to prepare ourselves when death approaches, but to be ready for His coming, because when we least expect it, the Son of Man shall come and demand an account of our whole life. And in the confusion of death, you know, it's going to be most difficult to adjust our accounts so as to appear guiltless before the tribunal of Jesus Christ. Perhaps death may not come upon us for another 20 or 30 years, but, you know, it may also come very soon, perhaps a year or in a month, maybe even today. If anyone has reason to fear that a trial should take place on which his life depended, he certainly wouldn't wait for the day of the trial, but would, you know, as soon as possible, employ an advocate to plead our cause. And of course, our advocate is Our Lady, which you already know. But, you know, I digress. We'll be talking about Our Lady. What do we do? We know for certain the day will come when we will be judged, and that on the result of that judgment, our eternal life depends. We also know that that day may be very near at hand, and still, we waste our time instead of adjusting our accounts. We go on daily multiplying the crimes which will merit for us a sentence of severe punishment. I mean, you know, are we insane or what? If we have previously employed our time in offending God, let us from this moment forward regret our misfortune for the remainder of our life, and make reparation with a penitent heart.
Now the Lord gives us the remaining days of our life that we may compensate the time that has been poorly spent. St. Peter says God's patient with us in order to give us time to repent. St. Paul admonishes us, while we have time, let us do good. Let us not provoke the Lord, you know, to punish us by an unhappy death. And if during the years gone by we had been foolish and have offended him, let us now heed this apostle's exhortation, you know, to be wise for the future and to redeem the time that we have lost. See therefore, brethren, now that you walk vigilantly, not as the unwise, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil, understanding what is the will of God. Well, the days are evil. According to St. Anselm, the meaning of these words is that the days of this life are evil because in them, you know, we're exposed to a thousand temptations and dangers of eternal misery, and therefore, to escape perdition, all possible care is necessary. St. Augustine says, what is meant by redeeming the time? Well, unless, when necessary, to submit to temporal loss in order to gain eternal goods. We should live only to fulfill with all diligence the divine will. And, you know, should it be necessary, it's better to suffer in temporal things than to neglect our eternal interests. St. Paul sure redeemed time which he had lost. St. Jerome says, Paul, the last in the order of the apostles, but the first in merits, because he labored more than all. Let us consider that in each moment we may lay up greater treasures of eternal goods. If the possession, you know, of all the land that we could walk around, or the money which we could count in a day were promised, people would lose no time. They would instantly begin to walk around all the property that they wanted, or to start counting the money promised to them. Each one of us now has it within our grasp, has the power to acquire at each moment of each day eternal treasures. But, you know, will we store up treasure in heaven with the time given to us, or will we continue misusing our time? We must not give in to the temptation to put off till tomorrow, because if we do that, well, this day will be lost as well. You know, even the last hour we will never have. The last hour is gone. What did we do with it? You know, the last hour, the last day shall never return. We have this day. This is the day of salvation. But perhaps tomorrow will not be given to us.
We don't know.
Let's ask Our Lady to help us spend our time well. St. Alphonsus knew this so well that he made a vow to God never to waste time. May God bless you and Mary.
My children and my servants or employees, or you know, if you're in a position of authority when necessary, children, you know, if you're a teacher, but that I must raise my voice against disorders which I witness. Well, Saint Alphonsus says, you know, it's one thing to be angry against a brother and another to be displeased at the sin of a brother. So, you know, you don't get angry at your children when they offend you. You get disappointed, you know, that they offended God, that, and your correction of them has to be because of that not because you're angry that they upset you, but that your concern is for their spiritual welfare. You know, to be angry against sin is not anger, but it's zeal. And therefore, it's not only lawful, it's sometimes a duty. Parents have to correct and discipline their children, but not in anger. it's one thing, you know, to be upset with with people. And then we get upset with ourselves because we're upset. But our anger must be accompanied by prudence and has to be directed against the sin and not against the sinner. For, you know, if a person whom we correct perceive that we speak through passion and hatred towards them, the corrections will not be profitable and may even be mischievous or destructive. You know, to be angry then against a brother, a brother's sin is certainly lawful. St. Augustine says he's not angry with a brother who is angry against a brother's sin. King David said, you know, we may be angry without sin, but to be angry against a brother on account of a sin which he has committed is not lawful. Because, according to St. Augustine, we're not allowed to hate others for their vices. We have to have compassion on them and know, you know, there for the grace of God go I. According to St. Thomas Aquinas, anger, when fully voluntary, is accompanied with a desire of revenge. But someone may say, I resent such an injury. God will have pity on me because I have just grounds for resentment. But who, St. Thomas asked, has told you that you have just grounds for seeking revenge? It is you whose understanding is clouded by passions that you say this. And I've already said that anger obscures the mind and takes away our reason and understanding. And as long as the passion of anger lasts, you'll consider your neighbor's conduct very unjust and intolerable. But when your anger shall have passed and you cool down, well, you'll see that his act was not so bad as it appeared to be. But though the injury be grievous, or God will not have compassion if you seek revenge, because, you know, he says, vengeance for sins belongs not to you, but to me. And when the time shall come, I shall chastise them that deserve it. Revenge is mine. I will repay them in due time. We read in Deuteronomy. If you resent an injury done to you by your neighbor, God will justly inflict vengeance on you for all the injuries that you have offended him. You know, to the measure you measure out with will be measured back to you, our Lord says. So he that seeks revenge himself shall find vengeance from the Lord. Man to man reserves anger, but does he seek a remedy from God? St. Augustine says, you know, how can he who will not obey a command of God to pardon his neighbor expect to obtain from God the forgiveness of his own sins? So we implore the Lord to preserve us from yielding to any strong passion, and particularly to anger. Give me not over to shameful and foolish thoughts. For he that submits to such a passion is exposed to great danger of falling into grievous sin against God or his neighbor. You know, how many, in consequence of not controlling anger, break into a horrible blasphemies against God and his saints. But, you know, at the very time we're aflame with indignation, God is armed with scourges. The Lord said one day to the prophet Jeremiah, "What do you see, Jeremiah?" And I said, "I see a rod watching. Lord, I behold a rod watching to inflict punishment." The Lord asked him again, "What do you see?" And I said, "I see a boiling cauldron." The boiling cauldron is a figure of a man inflamed with wrath and threatened with a rod. That's the vengeance of God. Behold then the ruin which anger unrestrained brings upon us. You know, it deprives us first of the grace of God and afterwards of life itself. Envy and anger shorten a man's days, we read in the book of Ecclesiastes. And Job says, "Anger indeed kills the foolish. All the days of their life, persons addicted to anger are unhappy, you know, because they're always upset." Now, you know, let us consider how we should control our anger when provoked. You know, in the first place, it's necessary to know that it's not possible for human weakness in the midst of so many occasions, you know, to be altogether free from every emotion of anger. No one, as Seneca says, can be entirely exempt from this passion. Even St. Paul, you know, he says, "Let your anger be without sin." Notice, he doesn't say, "Don't get angry. We're human. We have emotions. It happens. But let your anger be without sin." All of our efforts must be directed to the moderation of the feelings of anger which spring up in our soul. How are they to be moderated? Well, by meekness. You know, this is called the virtue of the Lamb. That is, you know, the virtue of Jesus Christ. Because like a lamb, without anger or even complaint, he bore the pain and sorrows of his passion and crucifixion. He also told us to learn of me, for I'm meek and humble of heart. Now, that's a problem today because a lot of people today equate meekness with weakness. But actually, the exact opposite is true. It takes a very strong person to be meek, to turn the other cheek, to accept insults and persecution and correction meekly. One thing is for sure, and that is how pleasing in the sight of God are the meek, who submit in peace to all the crosses, the misfortunes, the persecutions, the injuries they endure. The meek are promised the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the meek, for they shall possess the land. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. Some boast of their meekness, but without any grounds. For they're meek only towards those who praise and confer favors on them, but to those who admonish them, they're full of fury and vengeance. The virtue of meekness consists in being meek and peaceful toward those who maltreat us. St. Paul tells us, to put on heartfelt compassion, to put on mercy, humility, modesty, and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If any have a complaint against another, forgive as the Lord has forgiven you. We read that in Colossians. You wish others to put up with your faults and to pardon you. You should act in the same manner towards them. Whenever you receive an insult from a person who upsets you, remember that a mild answer breaks wrath. There was a certain monk who passed through the cornfield of a farmer, and he ran out into the field and spoke. Start chewing this guy out and just using offensive language. The monk humbly replied, "Brother, you're right. I've done wrong. Pardon me." And by this answer, he just disarmed the man, so much so that he was so appeased that he instantly became calm and he left the world and joined religion. The proud make use of humiliations. I talked a little about this earlier, but the humiliations they receive actually increases their pride. Because they don't accept it graciously. But the humble and the meek turn contempt and insults offered them into an occasion for advancing in humility. St. Bernard says he is humble who converts humiliation into humility. In other words, God gives us the opportunity to acquire humility through humiliation. And we think of being humiliated as an awful thing, but you know, in reality, it's a gift from God, an occasion for growing in virtue. And the whole life of perfection we're called to basically boils down to growing in virtue, becoming more conformed to Christ, more patient, more humble, more merciful, forgiving. A man of meekness, says St. John Chrysostom, is useful to himself and to others. The meek are useful to themselves because, according to Father Alvarez, the time of humiliation and contempt is for them the time of merit. That's why Jesus calls his disciples happy when they shall be reviled and persecuted. Blessed are you when they shall revile you and persecute you. That's why the saints have always desired to be despised as Jesus, their master, was. The meek are useful to others because there is nothing better calculated than to draw others to God, than to see a Christian meek and cheerful when he receives an injury or an insult, just like that story we heard about the monk in the cornfield. And the reason is because virtue is known by being tried. Gold and silver are tried in the fire, but the acceptable person in the furnace of humiliation. That's also Ecclesiasticus. In the Canticle of Canticles, we read, "My spikenard," says the spouse in the Canticles, "sent forth the odor thereof." Now, what does that mean? Well, spikenard is a plant that is full of a very pleasing smell, but it diffuses its odors only when it's torn or bruised. So in this passage, the inspired writer wants us to understand that a person can't be said to be meek unless he's known to send forth the odor of his meekness by bearing injuries and insults in peace and without anger. So God wishes us to be meek, even toward ourselves. When a person commits a fault, God certainly wishes him to humble himself and to be sorry for his sin and resolve never to sin again. You know, he doesn't want us to be upset with ourselves and give way to anger or agitation because when a soul is agitated, it's just incapable of prayer. Praying well or doing good, So when we receive an insult, it takes heroic virtue. I mean, we have to do violence to ourselves to control our anger. Let us either answer with meekness as recommended above, or let us remain silent as recommended last night. And then, as St. Isidore says, we shall conquer. But if you answer through passion, you're going to not only do harm to yourselves, but to others. You know, it would be still worse to give an angry answer to a person who corrects you, you know. People do not get angry or even become indignant with those who wound their soul by flattery. But, you know, they're filled with indignation against those persons who censures them, or in order to correct their faults. You know, you can have the greatest, most charitable intentions to try to point out someone's fault or error. And, you know, fraternal correction is very rarely accepted graciously, which is sad. The Book of Proverbs, we read, because they have despised all my reproofs, their prosperity shall destroy them. No. Fools regard prosperity to be free from correction or to despise the admonitions which they receive, but such prosperity is the cause of their ruin. When you meet with an occasion of anger, you must, in the first place, be on your guard not to allow anger to enter your heart. You know, be quick not to anger, we read in Scripture. Some persons will even change color or go ballistic at every contradiction and correction. And when anger has entered them, you know, God only knows what it will lead to. Like I said earlier, you know, it leads to murder even. That's why we must really consider these occasions to anger, you know, in our meditations and prayer. You know, when we know those times when our blood starts to boil and we find ourselves growing impatient. We know from experience what it feels like. That's what we have to take to prayer, because, you know, unless we're prepared for these tests God gives us, and they're tests, they're challenges, or they're, better yet, opportunities that God gives us to get a handle on our anger, because he wants us to get a handle on it. So if a child fails a test, a good teacher makes them take it over until they get it right. So if we're getting angry all the time, or you can use it with anything, we're impatient, well, if we pray for patience, you got to remember to fasten your seatbelt, because God's going to send you a dozen people pushing your buttons. He'll give you all kinds of opportunities to practice patience. That's how much he loves you. You know, once you start passing the test, then these people aren't going to be a problem. Once we get a handle on our anger, we won't be flying off the handle anymore. Once we start passing the test, there won't be any. There'll be another test, because we'll have to grow in some virtue.
So we need to know those occasions before they happen, so we can pray. We got to be prepared for them, because you know it's just as difficult to restrain anger. The ball gets rolling, you might as well try putting a bridle on a horse while it's running away. So whenever we have the misfortune, you know, to permit anger to enter the soul, let us be careful to not allow it to remain. Jesus tells all who remember that, you know, if a brother is offended with them, not even to offer your gift at the altar, but first being reconciled with your brother, and then come and offer your gifts. And, you know, if we've been offended, well, we should endeavor to root out from our heart not only all anger, but also every feeling of bitterness toward the person who has offended us. You know, let all bitterness, says St. Paul, and anger and indignation be put away from you. As long as anger continues, we have to follow the advice of Seneca. He says, when you shall be angry, do nothing, say nothing which may be dictated by anger. Like David, you know, be silent and do not speak, that you feel that, you know, if you're still disturbed. How many, when inflamed with anger, say things later off, or later on, after they've cooled off, you know, they just regret they ever said that. But as long as anger lasts, we must be silent and abstain from doing or resolving, you know, to do anything. For what is done in the heat of anger will, according to St. James, be unjust. You know, it's also necessary to abstain from, you know, talking to people or consulting people who might provoke our indignation. King David says, blessed is the man who has not walked in the counsels of the ungodly. To him who has asked for advice, Ecclesiasticus says, if you blow on a spark, it shall burn, become a fire. And if you spit on it, it's going to be quenched. So when a person is indignant, you know, at some injury which he has received, by exhorting the person to patience, you know, you extinguish the fire. But if you encourage revenge, then you may kindle a great flame. So let him then who feels himself in any way inflamed with anger be on his guard against false friends who by an imprudent word may cause his perdition. We have to follow the advice of St. Paul to the Romans. Be not overcome by evil, but overcome evil by good. No. Be not overcome by evil. That means don't be conquered by sin. If through anger you seek revenge or utter blasphemies, then you are overcome by sin. And some people might say, well, you know, I'm naturally hot-tempered. I'm by the grace of God and, you know, by doing violence to yourself, you'll be able to conquer your natural disposition. Do not consent to anger, and you shall subdue the heart. You know, you'll calm the heat of your anger. And they say, well, you know, I cannot bear with unjust treatment. Well, our Lord did. You can tell them first to, you know, remember that anger does obstruct reason and prevents us from seeing things the way they are. And that's the result of sin. You know, sin blinds us. People talk about people they know, relatives and friends, people losing their faith, you know. But they first kill their conscience. You know, we all have a conscience, and we have to listen to it. But sin is what kills the conscience, because it darkens the mind, it dulls the intellect. That people don't think straight. That's why they can... they think they're performing good works by fighting to keep the woman's right to kill her baby, you know, and that they're doing all in their power to keep abortion legal. That's the result of sin. It blinds us. But there is no loss of faith if we ask forgiveness of sins. Every loss of faith is always preceded by repeated, unrepentant, mortal sin. So that's just taken to the extreme, but we do need to get a... It starts small. You know, maybe just missing Mass here and there, and then they get out of the habit of going to Mass, and then they just don't go. And one sin begets sin, just like virtue begets virtue. So, you know, secondly, if you return if evil for evil, well, you know, our enemy's won. He's gained the victory over us. We have to rather, as St. Paul says, overcome evil by good. Render every foe good for evil. Do good, our Lord says, to them that hate you and persecute you. This is the revenge of the saints. And it's called by St. Paulinus, heavenly rage. Revenge, I'm sorry. It is by such revenge that you shall gain the victory. And should any of those whom the prophet says, of whom the prophet says, the venom of asp is under their lips. Ask how can you submit to such an injury? Well, you just let your answer be, you know, the chalice which my Father hath given me, shall I not drink it? You know, whenever the saints received unjust punishment, some of them were really treated horrible by their siblings, by their spouses. They would just say, I deserve much worse, you know. And we follow that example of Jesus. I open not my mouth. You know, that's what he did. And because one thing we know is it's certain that every cross that befalls us comes from God. So, should anyone take away your property? Well, recover it if you can. But if you cannot, you can say with Job, "The Lord has given and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." You know, there was a certain philosopher who had lost some of his goods in a storm. I said, "Well, you know, just because I lost my goods, I will not lose my peace. There's bigger fish to fry." Or like the young man in the gospel, our Lord was preaching one day, and he said, "Lord, tell my brother to give me my share of the inheritance." Now, that's unjust. And what did our Lord say? "Who made you me my arbitrator?" It's like, don't worry about it. That you can't take it with you, you know. We have to be concerned with more important matters, spiritual matters. So just because you may have lost some property, you can say, "I'm not going to lose my soul." Just remember, you know, when we meet with crosses, persecutions and injuries, we just turn to God, who commands us to bear with these things in patience, and then we shall always avoid anger. We have to consider the will of God, you know, which disposes things in this manner for our greater sanctification. That's everything that happens to us, whether it's good, it's a wonderful person that God's put into our life that helps us and teaches us and inspires us, or whether it's our next door neighbor chewing us out for a leaf of ours, blowing a leaf from our tree, falling on their property. It's all for a greater sanctification. And then anger is going to cease. You know, we have to look at Jesus crucified, and we won't have the courage to complain. Saint Eleazar, Franciscan tertiaries, he and his wife, you know. She asked him one day how he bore so many injuries without yielding to anger. And he answered, I turn to Jesus Christ, and that's how I preserve my peace. So finally, you know, remember, just remember the sins, you know, that we have committed throughout our whole life and for which we deserve far worse treatment. And we shall calmly submit to all the crosses that we've been asked to carry. St. Augustine says that though we're sometimes innocent of the crime for which we've been accused or persecuted, we're nevertheless guilty of other sins which should have merited a greater punishment, but, you know, we got away with. Not that we ever get away with any sin. We have to answer for everything on Judgment Day. I know this is one of my longer conferences, but speaking of crosses and conformity to God's will, I have to share with you a reading, but this prayer at the end of the chaplet still really says it all too. I could have just let the conference go. Eternal God, in whom mercy is endless and the treasury of compassion inexhaustible, look kindly upon us and increase your mercy in us, that in difficult moments we might not despair nor become despondent, but with great confidence submit ourselves to your holy will, which is love and mercy itself. That's hard to swallow when you're suffering great pain from an injury or a sickness or injustice. But here's what St. Rose has left us. It's found in the Office of Readings from her feast day, from her writings. It starts off, she's actually quoting Jesus. This is Jesus speaking, the Son of God, the second person of the Blessed Trinity. So when Jesus speaks, we should listen. Okay. Our Lord and Savior lifted up his voice and said with incomparable majesty, let all men know that grace comes after tribulation. Let them know that without the burden of afflictions, it is impossible to reach the height of grace. Let them know that the gifts of grace increase as the struggles increase. Let men take care not to stray or be deceived. This is the only true stairway to paradise. And without the cross, they can find no road to climb to heaven. Now, this is St. Rose. And when I heard these words, a strong force came upon me and seemed to place me in the middle of a street so that I might say in a loud voice to people of every age, sex, and status, hear, O people, hear, O nations, I am warning you about the commandment of Christ by using words that came from his own lips. We cannot obtain grace unless we suffer afflictions. We must heap up trouble upon trouble to obtain a deep participation in the divine nature and glory of the sons of God and perfect happiness of soul. That same force strongly urged me to proclaim the beauty of divine grace. It pressed me so that my breath came slow and forced me to sweat and pant. I felt as if my soul could no longer be kept in the prison of the body, but that it had burst its chains and was free and alone and was going very swiftly through the whole world, saying, if only mortals would learn how great it is to possess divine grace, how beautiful, how noble, how precious, how many riches it hides within itself, how many joys and delights. Without doubt, they would devote all their care and concern to winning for themselves pains and afflictions. All men throughout the world would seek trouble, infirmities, and torments instead of good fortune, in order to obtain the unfathomable treasure of grace. This is the reward and the final gain of patience. No one would complain about his cross or about troubles that may happen to him if he would come to know the scales on which they are weighed when they are distributed to men. Praise be Jesus and Mary. Tonight I'm going to share with you some thoughts of Father John Hurton on penance and reparation. Penance and reparation are a result of sin. They're the price we have to pay for our own sins and the sins of others. And finally, penance and reparation are what God requires from sinners is a condition for showing them his mercy. In order to better understand the meaning of penance and reparation, we have to look for a moment what happens, when we sin. I mentioned some of the results of sin earlier. First of all, we incur guilt before God just for the self-will that caused us to sin. We become more or less separated from God or estranged from God, depending upon the gravity of our sin. Like a lot of people, they would only have a problem with venial sin because it doesn't separate us from God. Well, it doesn't sever that relationship, but it does separate us from God. Our venial sins, our faults and failings are obstacles in our life, keeping us from a deeper relationship with God. God would love a deeper relationship with us. But if it's going to happen, we have to be the ones to do something about it. Because God, we know, cannot love us any more than he already does. He loves us infinitely. You cannot love more than an infinite amount of love. So one way of deepening that relationship is what we're going to be talking about tonight. So our sins do separate us from God, more or less, depending on the gravity. Secondly, we deserve a punishment for the disorder we caused by our sinful conduct. We become liable to suffering pain. Again, more or less pain, depending on how seriously that we've done wrong. In other words, every sin has consequences, and those consequences are called temporal punishment. Temporal, that deals with time. And, in other words, not just the temporal punishment, but, you know, in other words, pain, either in this life or in the next. So against this background, we can more easily see the meaning of penance and reparation. Penance is the repentance that we must make to remove guilt or to reinstate ourselves into God's friendship. Now, reparation is the pain that we must endure to make up for the harm we brought about by our self-indulgence when we sinned. So what then do penance and reparation have in common? Well, they have this in common, that they're absolutely necessary. You know, if the justice of God is to be satisfied after we offended the divine majesty, they also have this in common, that God now has a right, you know, to demand more of us than he would have required had we not committed sin. So this word "more" is going to be coming up over and over again. It's very basic to any correct understanding, you know, of penance and reparation. But, you know, if penance and reparation have these things in common, well, how do they differ? They differ, as we have seen, in the two different ways that we do wrong whenever we sin. Because we've failed in loving God, we now owe him more love than he would have required had we not offended him. So, you know, like when your child disobeys you, offends you, and you forgive him, you know, he gives you a hug. He gives you more love than he would have if he had not disobeyed you. So when we do wrong by our willful love of self, we have to make up by our selfless love of God. This is penance. And, you know, because we have brought disorder into the world by our sins, we must undergo pain to undo the harm we have caused. This is reparation. Yeah. I don't know if you may have heard that analogy, you know, when, like, you tell your child, don't play catch, you know, in front of the new picture window in the living room. And of course they go out into the front yard and they're throwing the baseball, and inevitably it goes through the window. So you forgive your child, but you punish him. You, after the spanking, you still say, well, you know, this window's broken, we're going to have to dock your allowance, you know, to help pay for the window. Well, you could dock his allowance for years. It's never going to come close to paying for the window. But at least he's doing something. He's contributing. He's making up for the damage that he caused by his disobedience. And that's what we do. We're God's children. We were adopted the day we were baptized. And if parents expect obedience and respect from their children, well, why should God be any different? You know, why? Well, that's the big question. You know, is God a sadist or what? You know, we know God is not a sadist. This was not in his plan. Remember, we said penance and reparation is a result of sin. He created everything good. There was no suffering, no pain, no sorrow, no penance, no reparation. So if we ask, well, why is penance and reparation? Why for it? Well, because, you know, the obvious answer is God wants it. But like I said, he wants it of our own free will. He didn't want it to begin with, but after man sinned, it's required. And so if we press the question, why does God want it? Well, we have to say, you know, in God's mysterious wisdom, remember, he doesn't think as we think, but in his mysterious wisdom, you know, his justice requires it. We may legitimately say, without really understanding it, that he doesn't have a choice. Having given us free will, if we abuse liberty, we must use our freedom to repay to God the love that we have stolen from him, the obedience we owe to him. That's penance. And to strive to repair the damage that we have caused. That's reparation. Notice, you know, all along I've been using the first person plural, we, because penance and reparation are owed to God, not only because, you know, I have individually sinned, but because we human beings have sinned and are sinning, you know, in our day, on a scale never even conceived in the annals of history. You know, we know better than Cain after he killed his brother Abel. You know, we are our brother's keepers. We're mysteriously co-responsible for what other people do wrong. You know, that's why the church requires priests and religious, and it encourages lay people, you know, to pray the divine office. It's a communal prayer that builds up the body of Christ, because when we sin, we tear at the very fabric of our Lord's mystical body. It has a communal aspect. There's a profound sense, you know, in which all of us somehow are to do penance and make reparation, not only for our sinful misdeeds, but for the sins of our country, and indeed the sins of the whole human race. We know this from the lives of the saints. Some of those saints were as pure as angels, and they would scourge themselves till they bled in atonement for the sins of the flesh of other people. Or they would fast for the sins of gluttony. Now we return to our question. Well, why penance and reparation? Well, because in our Lord's own words, unless you do penance, you shall all likewise perish. For those who have not preserved baptismal innocence, penance is not an option. You know, is it any wonder that on Pentecost Sunday, after Peter preached his sermon and rebuked the people for their sins, they asked him, well, what must we do to be saved? What must we do? His first word to them was repent. You know, again, at Fatima, you know, Our Lady's message to a sinful world may be summarized in the same imperative: do penance. The souls are being lost. She showed the children a vision of hell, falling into purgatory or hell like snowflakes. They saw a vision of purgatory too, but that could be prevented if we would do penance and pray more, sacrifice more. You know, just think of all the calamities that took place in the past century. Two world wars with more casualties than all previous wars in history. The number of abortions just dwarfs all the casualties of every war that's ever been or probably ever will be. The threat of a nuclear holocaust that hangs over us. All of this is God's warning to do penance and reparation. Why? Why? Well, because God is not mocked. You know, do you think humanity, us included, can offend God with impunity? We don't sin without retribution. We don't ignore the will of the Almighty and expect God to ignore what we do. What bears emphasis, however, is that this retribution is either paid willingly with our penance and reparation, or it will be paid unwillingly with divine punishment. You know, the divine logic is simple, very simple. God is telling us we either do penance and reparation now of our own free will, or we shall suffer the consequences of our sins in this life and the life to come. But, you know, remember, this penance and reparation is to be done not only for what we have personally done wrong, it's for all the pride and lust, for all the cruelty and greed, for all of the envy and laziness and gluttony of a sin-laden human family. And God is merciful. And Jesus Christ is the incarnation of divine mercy. But God's mercy is conditional. It's conditional on our practice of penance and reparation. Now, we come to the third, and in a way, the most important subject. How? How do we practice penance and reparation? Now, you know, Father Horton says it's the most important because, you know, we could talk for hours about the theology of penance and reparation. And, you know, we may end up a little wiser, perhaps, but not holier. He said, you know, it's one thing to know how to become a saint. It's something entirely different becoming one. We have to take the next and final step and ask ourselves practically, how am I going to accomplish this? Well, thanks be to God. Father Horton has left us 7 rules. 3 for penance and 4 for reparation. Number 1, pray. Number 2, share. Number 3, forgive. Penance, these are the rules for penance, which we perform to make up for our failure in loving God. So, number 4, work. Work, number 4. Number 5, endure. Number 6, deprive. Number 7, sacrifice. And so these are the rules for reparation, which we perform, you know, for the punishment, in reparation for the punishment that we and others have deserved for our sins. So now we spend a moment on each one of these 7 rules and, you know, just ask our Lord to open our hearts to respond with generosity to his offended sacred heart, you know. And that's really one of the secrets to progress in the spiritual life, is generosity. How generous are we? How willing are we to give to God? Are we willing to give everything? Rule number 1, pray. God expects more of us because we have sinned. And the first, more, that all of us can put into practice is more prayer. And you say, well, Father, I pray all day. Okay. That's fine. Can you pray better? You know? So not only giving more time each day to prayer, but maybe attending Mass more often. Well, if you go 7 days a week, that's great. And we know Our Lady of Fatima requested that we pray the rosary every day. She didn't say go to Mass every day. She knows not everyone can get to Mass every day. But, you know, for us who can, well, let's, if we're going to Mass every day, well, let's try to do it more attentively, and reciting the rosary more frequently. And you recite the rosary every day? Well, that's fine. You know, Padre Pio prayed over 100 rosaries every day. So we can always pray more rosaries, being more attentive when we pray. You know, placing ourselves in the presence of God, that's the essence of prayer. Just being aware that we're in His presence. Having more fervor in our life of prayer. Or getting more people to pray with us. I know some of you have prayer groups, and that's great. Or praying as a family. You know, that's a great way to make sure that we're getting our prayers in, not only fulfilling that obligation as spiritual leaders of your domestic church, but there's some accountability there. Okay, it's time to pray, you know, hold each other to accountability. Are we going to pray? You know, read the scriptures, pray the rosary. The family that prays together stays together. So no matter what, the first rule of effective penance is more prayer. Rule number two, share. Remember what our Lord told us the night before He died. A new commandment I give to you. He's speaking in the imperative. Commandment. It doesn't say suggestion. He expects this. He demands this. That you love one another as I have loved you. He died. He was scourged. He was crowned with thorns. Do we love people we don't even care about that persecute us? Do we love them that much that we would do that for them? If all sin is a failure in loving God, and we mainly show our love for God by loving one another, then you know, we'd better show our love for others by sharing with what God has given to us. St. John says, how can you say you love the God you cannot see when you don't love the brother you can see? Again, you know, that word more comes into play. And we have to examine our conscience and ask ourselves, you know, what more can I share with those whom God has placed in my life? With whom God has placed in my life. You mean those obnoxious people I can't stand? Yeah. Yeah, God put them in your life. Yeah. The people who take advantage of your charity? Yeah. Them too. If they're in your life, God put them there. It wasn't the stray cat or the tree that fell in your car that put those people in your life. It's God. Can I give more time to others? Can I share more of my knowledge with others? Can I share more of my skill with others? Can I share more of my money with others? God loves a cheerful giver, and giving alms covers a multitude of sins. Can I share more of my Catholic faith with others? We have a treasure that is inexhaustible. We can share it with everyone and not be deprived of anything. Each one of us is different in this matter. This matter of sharing, because you know, each one of us is living a totally different life with different people whom God's providence places in our path. So the second rule for the practice of penance, remember this is penance. it doesn't have to be enjoyable, but the saints found the most difficult things and the most irksome and bothersome things, when done for penance and love of God, became sweet, and they would desire to do these things. The third rule of penance is to forgive. Our Lord could not have been more explicit in urging us to forgive others who offend us. He gave whole parables on the subject of forgiveness. He warned us that God will be as merciful to us as we are forgiving to others. He placed in the center of the Lord's Prayer a frightening invocation. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. If a person cannot forgive someone, and they pray the Our Father, they're asking God not to forgive them. Therefore, we must ask ourselves, can I be more forgiving and forgetting of what others have done to me? Now, you know, forgiveness, love, some of these things, you know, they're acts of the will and the intellect. That sounds very philosophical, and it is. So emotions are irrelevant. We know intellectually, God asks us to forgive. It's not an option. And he's given us a free will. We choose. We can choose. I choose to forgive you. I choose not to. I'm going to hold a grudge. And some people hold grudges for decades, which is sad if they're praying to Our Father. Scary, really. So we know intellectually we have to forgive. And you just make the choice. Okay, I forgive you. Now, sometimes we question our forgiveness because the next time we see that person, the anger flares up, the pain is remembered, the injustice. That's irrelevant. They're just emotions. Let your anger be without sin. You just reject them in the name of Jesus. And every time those emotions flare up, each time you reject them, it's an act of love for God, an increase in merit. You've made the act. You've made the choice to forgive. It's done. So don't second guess yourself or question your forgiveness. Just don't pay attention to the emotions. Now, can I be more forgiving by ignoring the unkindness, the thoughtlessness. Sometimes it's not even malicious. They're just thoughtless, like men. It doesn't even cross their mind to send a thank you card, and people get offended. Oh, you didn't. Well, just give them a break. How many breaks has God given us? You know, just. And don't let your right hand know what your left hand's doing. God sees what you've done, and He'll reward you. So in gratitude, and perhaps even meanness, maybe it was malicious. That's irrelevant. The other person's intentions are irrelevant. Your response is what matters. So and all these things that we have inflicted upon us, well, can we be more forgiving of those too, you know? And like I said, you know, no two of us are living the same lives. Each of us have different people saying or doing or failing to say and do things that hurt us and perhaps crush the very heart of our souls. Nevertheless, the third rule of penance is more forgiving. You don't need barbed wire. Bishop Sheen said our neighbor is our hair shirt. So this again, you know, is penance, you know. Now, rule number four, work. So we shift from penance to reparation. This is a rule for reparation. And our first directive is to work. So, you know, how's work a form of reparation for sin? Well, you have to remember, in the garden, you know, that was a consequence of sin. You shall work by the sweat of your brow. You shall toil. And thorns and thistles will be the fruit of your work. So it's a reparation because fallen human nature dislikes to exert itself. Work is a form of mortification that all of us can look to see whether we could not work harder or, you know, do the work or, you know, we do the performance of our task, just as fulfilling those duties in our state in life. You know, we want to give a honest day's work for an honest day's wage. That's justice. By nature, you know, we're prone to first do what we like, and then to do what is useful, and then to do what is necessary. That's the way it works with most people. And I can think of a better, a more effective kind of reparation than in setting our minds, you know, to reversing that order. First, you can do what is necessary. Then you do what is useful. And then you do what you want, what you like, you know. So anyway, that's the fourth rule, work. That's the first rule of reparation, but the fourth rule for reparation, penance and reparation. So number five, endure. Okay. Oh, in some ways, this is kind of the keystone of reparation. Just the patient endurance of suffering the trials God sends us. Say, well, God didn't send that. That was the neighbor who I hate and did that to me. Well, no, it's a trial. And that neighbor is God's chosen instrument. He put him in your life for your greater sanctification. Can never forget that, you know. God in his mercy sends us the cross in order to try our patience, that we might save our souls and the souls of many others. The variety of these trials sent by God defies classification and intensity. Depends on a thousand factors that differ with different people. But, you know, he will never give anyone more than they can handle. Like that parable of the talents. He gave one servant 5 talents, another 2, another 1. He's not going to give you what you're not capable of. He knows each one of our capabilities. And we have to admit, there's no matter how bad we are, we can always find someone that has to suffer much more. If we're to expiate sin, we must resign ourselves to endure pain. Remember, that's the consequence of sin. Temporal punishment, pain. But as we know, there are degrees to this resignation. That's why I said everything in our spiritual progress depends upon our generosity. Are we resigned to accept misunderstanding from others with greater peace of mind? Can we be more generous in doing what we know God wants us to do, although it may be painful? To maybe admit we were wrong, or to seek reconciliation with an unreconcilable person. But at least they have to know we're open to reconciliation. Even if we know it's going to be rejected, we have to give them that opportunity to know we want to set things right before we face judgment, you know. Can we suffer without pitying ourselves? Can we put up with discomfort? Maybe sitting on a wooden chair instead of a recliner. Or distaste, eating something we may not care for. Or doing without something we do care for. Our disability without becoming bitter about what we're tempted to consider injustice on the part of God. Why me? You know, you can have 2 different people. One, like they get the diagnosis of cancer, terminal, and one can accept it in reparation for sins, the sins of others, the conversion of loved ones, and accept the will of God, and others can become bitter and angry. You know, God does this out of love for his children. And many of them, you know, get really ticked off at him, and some even abandoned him. But in other words, God's so-called injustice are really blessings. And the crosses that he sends us are tokens of his love. We learn that from those writings of St. Rose. But how we need the light of faith to see this, and the strength of his grace to do this. To do this in reparation for sin. And, as the price we must pay to reach heaven, where every tear will be wiped away and all the past, which is now present, will have passed away. Rule number 6, deprive. So our 6th rule of reparation is practice reparation by depriving ourselves of something we now have, or something that we could have, if we wanted to. In other words, to do without. Maybe a luxury in the home, or some delicacy at table, or some comfort, in our way of living, or it could be just some trinket or grown-up toy, that we could just as well do without. Call it mortification or self-denial, whatever the name. The basic idea is to expiate for sins of self-indulgence by dying to self. When we offend God by choosing some creature to which we have no right, we practice mortification. We make reparation by choosing to deprive ourselves of some creature which we have a right to. Why? In order to undo the harm caused by sin. And thus we propitiate the offended justice of God. Justice is giving a person his due, what is due to him. So if a criminal commits a crime, he has to serve justice, and they give him what is his due, what's coming to him. And also, if a person does good, well, then they're rewarded. That's the way it works. So rule number 7, sacrifice. You share in the priesthood of the baptized, share in the priesthood of Jesus Christ. And what do priests do? Well, they offer sacrifice. Father Hardin saved sacrifice for the end because it synthesizes everything that we've said so far. So what is sacrifice? Well, sacrifice is the surrender of something to God. It is the heart of penance and reparation. When we sacrifice, we let go with our wills of whatever we could legitimately possess and enjoy, because we want to make up to God for having stupidly chosen some creature in preference to the Creator. We now return to where we began by stressing that, when we sacrifice, we do more than we would have done. We give up more than we would have given up. We surrender more than of what we like, in order to, in plain English, prove to God that we love Him. Married couples sacrifice to prove their love for one another. And they do without for their children out of love. So it's not an alien concept. There was a man years ago. This is a true story, and he was a very generous soul, and he resolved one day to if anyone ever asked him anything with the words, for the love of God, could you do this, give me an alms for the love of God, or help me to do this, for the love of God. If they included those words, then he resolved, or he may have even made a vow. I don't know. I can't remember, but it was in the Franciscan Book of Saints. And one day, a friar met him, and they were talking. He said, for the love of God, why don't you join us? It's like, whoa. He hadn't thought of becoming a Franciscan, but wow. Oh, if that's what God wants, he became a very holy guy, So, there's an episode in the gospel that perfectly synthesizes this cardinal mystery of sin and penitential reparation. You remember after the resurrection, when Christ asked Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? And why? Why the question? And because Peter had sinned more than the others. Therefore, he was expected to expiate more because he had so deeply sinned, by denying his Savior. So, as we look into our hearts, we must humbly confess that truly we have sinned often, sinned deeply, sinned willfully. But, God is good. He gives us the privilege, And it's a privilege. The angels were not given this privilege. They disobeyed once, and they were condemned to hell for all eternity. If angels could envy man, they would envy them for their privilege of doing penance in atonement for an offended, infinite God, and also
they would envy us for our privilege of being able to receive the Eucharist. So yes, God does give us the privilege of not only expiating what we have done wrong, but actually becoming more pleasing to Him by our penance and reparation. Saint Francis, you know, after his conversion, he did so much penance. I mean, at the end of his life, he apologized to his body because he was so hard on it. But our Lord revealed to them that after 2 years of penance, he atoned for all the temporal punishment due to his sins. But St. Francis did some heavy-duty penance. He fasted. He made 7 40-day fasts every year. That doesn't leave too many days without fasting. But, you know, it was no pious statement that St. Paul gave when he said, "Where sin abounded, grace has even more abounded." In other words, in God's providence, we know God doesn't want us to sin, but it happens. And St. Peter says God's so patient with us to give us time to repent, that so that we might repent and become saints like St. Francis by our penance and reparation. God bless you.
Praise be Jesus and Mary. Well, we've been talking about spiritual weapons for spiritual warfare. And now it's time to pull out the big guns. We know Our Lady is the mediatrix of all graces, the mediatrix of sinners. And, you know, divine grace is an infinite treasure because it makes us friends of God. In the Book of Wisdom, we read, "For she is an infinite treasure to men, which they that use become the friends of God." You know, it's amazing. People say, "Oh, there's not much in the Bible about Mary," but she's there from Genesis to Revelation. All the references in the Song of Songs and the Book of Wisdom and Proverbs. If there cannot be a greater happiness than to enjoy the grace of God, there cannot be a greater misery than to incur his displeasure by sin, which really makes us his enemies. In the Book of Wisdom we read, but to God, the wicked and his wickedness are hateful alike. Now, what about, we're told God loves the sinner and hates the sin. That's true, but that is to be properly understood. You see, we are what we do. We know that God hates murder. But if we murder, we're a murderer. So God does love the sinner, but not for what he is. He doesn't love murder. And murderers murder. So he doesn't love the sinner for what he is. He loves the sinner for what he can be. Because he's always giving us grace to change. Now, for those of us who have had the misfortune to forfeit divine grace by sin, we must never think of despairing. But, you know, we console ourselves with the fact that we have in Jesus Christ himself a mediator who can obtain pardon for us and restore the grace that we have lost. And he is the propitiation for our sins, St. John tells us in his first letter. What have we to fear, says St. Bernard, when we have recourse to so great a mediator? He can do all things with his eternal Father. He has satisfied the divine justice for us, continues St. Bernard, and has nailed our sins to the cross, having taken them away from our soul. But even with this knowledge, if we still fear to approach Jesus Christ on account of his divine majesty, God has given us another advocate with his Son. And we know that advocate is Our Lady. Mary has been given to the world as mediatrix between God and sinners. And we can listen to the words of the Holy Ghost, who speaks in the Canticle of Canticles. I am she, says, the refuge of those who fly to me, like a tower of defense to everyone who has recourse to me. And he who is the enemy of God, let him know that I am the mediatrix of peace between God and sinners. Mary, says the Venerable Bede, stands in the presence of her Son, praying unceasingly for sinners. And the Blessed Amadeo says that Mary, all-powerful. Now, you know, some people get worried when they refer to Mary as all-powerful. I mean, she's not divine. She's not God. But she is all-powerful in her intercession for sinners because
God cannot refuse her anything because he knows that she will never ask anything opposed to his will. And she never said no to God, and he will never say no to her. That's how it works, even with us. You know, people say, oh, God doesn't answer my prayers. I pray for this, I pray for that. A lot of times, I mean, that happens even when people do obey God and love him. But, you know, if we don't listen to God, why should we expect him to listen to us? But Our Lady did listen to God, always. And by her prayers, you know, she can come before God face to face, and she can continually intercede for us. She never ceases to implore God. By her all-powerful prayers, all obtains for us all the graces we need. We know Jesus merited our redemption on the cross and won for us all graces. But it was his will. He gave all those graces he merited to his mother to be dispensed. She's the dispensatrix of all graces, the mediatrix of all graces. You know, unfortunately, there are those who refuse the graces solicited for them by this, you know, loving mother, namely, you know, those who will not abandon sin, who will not give up this relationship or this approximate occasion of sin, who will not restore their neighbor's property, you know, those are they who will not receive the graces begged for them by our Lady, because, you know, Mary wishes to obtain for them the grace of breaking off these occasions of sin, but they just refuse to cooperate. And such as these, who refuse graces sought for them by Mary, will be lost. And, you know, she from heaven sees well all of our miseries and dangers, and you know how deeply it concerns her. We see this at Fatima, how she asked the children to pray for poor sinners that they not be lost, to make those sacrifices. She has compassion for us all, and with a motherly affection, you know, she's always endeavoring to assist us. Even when she appeared to St. Catherine Labouré with that request to make the miraculous medal, St. Catherine asked, well, she noticed the rings on Our Lady's fingers, and some of them were brighter than others, and Our Lady said, well, the ones that are not shining as brightly, those are the graces that no one's asking for. So the graces are available. You know, ask and you shall receive. One day, St. Bridget heard Jesus saying to Mary, Mother, ask of me what you will. And Mary replied, I ask mercy for the unfortunate. As if she were to say to him, Son, you know, since you've made me the mother of mercy, an advocate of sinners, can I ask anything else of you than mercy for the unhappy?
And let's face it, if someone's not trying to fulfill the will of God in their life, they're never going to be happy. They're not striving to live the Our Father and keep the commandments. They may have all the money in the world and they could buy anything they want, go anywhere they want, but that doesn't bring them happiness. How many people commit suicide that have more than enough of this world's goods? In a word, St. Austin says that, among all the saints, we have not any of them that are so solicitous for our salvation as Mary is. That's how mothers are concerned for their children, you know. The only difference with Mary is you can take the love of Mary or take all the love of all the mothers that ever have existed or who are existing and whoever will exist and combine them, and it won't equal the love that Our Lady has for one soul. Isaiah complains in his day as follows: "Behold, thou art angry. There is none who rise up and taketh hold of thee. Lord," said the prophet, "you are justly angry with us for our sins, and there is no one to appease you or to draw you from chastising us." St. Bonaventure says that, the prophet had a good reason for saying this and talking this way, since there was no Mary at that time. But at present, if Jesus wishes to chastise a sinner, and the sinner recommend himself to Mary, she, by her prayers, restrains her son and averts chastisement for the sinner. There is no one, he says, so well able to hold back the sword of the Lord. And Saint Andrew called Mary the peace of the Lord with men. St. Justin called her the arbitress, saying that, Jesus lays before Our Lady all his reasons for punishing us, that she may negotiate peace. And the sinner, on the other hand, places himself in her hands. Thus, Mary, on the one side, obtains for the sinner the grace of amendment and penance. On the other, she obtains a pardon for him of her son. And this is the vocation of Our Lady, her ministry, which she's continually occupied. When Noah judged that the flood was coming to an end, he sent out a dove from the ark, and she returned with an olive branch, a sign of peace from God that all was well, with the world. And the dove was a figure of Mary. St. Bonaventure says, "You, O Mary, are the dove, and who, interceding with God, have obtained for us peace and salvation." And I think it was Saint Epiphanius who asked, how is it that in the old law, you know, the Lord was so severe in his chastisements, you know, universal deluge, fire from heaven, fiery serpents, and the like. Whereas he now deals so mercifully with us, who have even sinned more grievously than the Israelites of old. And he answers, he does it all through love of Mary, who intercedes for us. Oh, how long since should the world have been destroyed, says Saint Fulgentius, if Mary had not intervened. And I know it's written somewhere, I think in the mystical city of God, that you know, God would have destroyed everything after Adam had sinned if he had not foreseen Mary. It was for her sake. That's why the church wishes to call the Blessed Mother our hope. And Martin Luther really had a problem with this, that the church should teach us to call Mary our hope. He said that our hope ought to rest in God alone, not in a creature, and that God curses him who places his confidence in creature. And he quoted Jeremiah, "Cursed be the man that trusteth in man." Well, that's true, but that has to be understood of those who trust in creatures in contempt of God or independently of him. But, you know, we hope in Mary as our mediatrix with the Lord. In the same way as Jesus, our mediator is with the Eternal Father. Because, you know, by the merits of his passion, he obtains pardon for penitent sinners. And Mary is the mediatrix by divine favor with her son. And as such, a mediatrix that her son grants her every request, and that he wills that every grace pass through her hands. You know, if people have a problem with Mary being the mediatrix, well, they need to talk to Jesus. It's his will. The Lord, says St. Bernard, has placed in Mary the plenitude of all good, so that Mary, the treasure of mercies, that he wishes to have bestowed on us, and therefore wishes that we should acknowledge every grace is coming from her. Well, St. Bernard calls for chief confidence and the principal ground, you know, of our hope. For which reason he exhorts us to look for grace always through the intercession of Mary. And for the same reason, you know, the church, despite Martin Luther, calls Mary our hope. The saints also call Mary the ladder and the moon and the city of refuge. She's called by St. Bernard the ladder of sinners. You know, if it's sin which separates us from God, and we read this in the prophet Isaiah, "But your iniquities have separated you from your God." And so a soul in the state of grace is in union with God, and God in union with it. You know, he that abideth in charity abideth in God, and God in him. But when the soul turns its back on God, then she's separated from him, plunged into the abyss of misery. And how great the filth of sin. And he can come out of the pit of perdition through Our Lady. You, says St. Bernard, do not abhor the sinner, however loathsome he may be, if he cries out to you. You stretch out your hand and draw him from the depths of despair. And for the same reason, she's called the moon. Fair is the moon. You know, as the moon, says St. Bernard, is placed between the sun and the earth, so is Mary stationed between God and us, you know, to pour out his graces continually upon us. You know, again, I think in the mystical city of God, it said that when God created the sun, he had Jesus, his son, in mind, that he's the light of the world. And we cannot exist without the sun. And when he created the moon, he had Mary in mind, because Mary is the perfect reflection of the sun. She's called the city of refuge. You know, in the ancient law, there were five cities of sanctuary to which if anyone fled, he was safe of not being pursued by justice, you know, no matter what his crimes. And they tried reviving that here recently, and I heard it didn't go too well for those sanctuary cities. But anyway, we have Mary, to whom if anyone shall flee, he may rest secure of not being pursued by divine justice. In the cities of old, you know, every criminal was not secure, nor could all of his crimes escape punishment. But Mary's the city of refuge, which receives every criminal. There's no one so much cast off by God, said the Blessed Mother to St. Bridget, who, if you have recourse to me, shall not return to God and receive pardon. And I'm sure that many of us have experienced that in our own life. Mary will never refuse to assist sinners. She is the advocate of sinners. It said that, you know, she told the venerable sister Mary Villain, next to my dignity of Mother of God, there is nothing which I so much value as my office of advocate of sinners. To this end, you know, St. John Chrysostom basically says, have you been chosen from eternity, Mother of God, that those whose sins should exclude them from participation in the merits of your Son might be made partakers of them by your intercession? This was the principal office for the fulfillment of which God created her and placed in her the world. Again, in the Book of Canticles, we read, you know, feed thy kids. And by kids, he means sinners. And those kids are given in the care of Mary, you know, in order that they, who on the day of judgment, should by their sins have deserved to stand on the left, may by her intercession stand upon the right. Saint Bridget one day heard Jesus saying to his mother, you know, you give assistance to everyone endeavoring to rise to God. Mary assists everyone who strives, you know, to leave his evil life and to turn to God. Or at least prays to her that he may receive the strength to do so. If he has not that desire, Our Lady herself can not assist him if he refuses to give up his sin. You know, Mary assists only those sinners who honor her by some special devotion, and who, you know, if they remain in disgrace with God, have recourse to her, that she may obtain pardon for them and effect their deliverance, you know, from their present condition. The sinner who acts in this way from his heart is secure, because Mary, as we have said, has been created that she might have charge of sinners and lead them to God. You know, the Lord himself revealed this to St. Catherine of Siena. And the Blessed Mother herself said to St. Bridget that as a magnet attracts iron, so she draws the hard hearts of men to herself and to God. But, you know, we always have to keep in mind that these hearts, despite their hardness, must desire liberation from their unhappy state. If only everyone had recourse to Mary with at least this desire, it is said that she would procure salvation for all. You know, what fear of damnation should that man feel, says the abbot, Adam, to whom Mary offers herself as a mother and an advocate? He asks again, could it be possible that you, the Mother of Mercy, should not intercede with the Redeemer for the soul he has redeemed? And he himself answers, you must intercede, because God has placed his Son as mediator between man and heaven, and has placed you as mediator between his Son and guilty man. St. Bernard says to the sinner, give thanks to him who has provided you with such a mediatrix. Thank your God who, in order to manifest his mercy towards you, has given you not only a son for a mediator in his own right, but that you might have more confidence, has given you Mary as a mediatrix with that son. St. Austin calls her the only hope of sinners. And St. Bernard says, if by reason of your iniquities you see the Lord in anger and fear to approach him, have recourse to the hope of sinners, who is Mary. She will not reject you because you are too wretched. It is her office to assist the wretched. And William of Paris basically says the same thing. It is thy office to place thyself between God and man. Therefore, you know, when we have recourse to Our Lady, let us all say to her with St. Thomas of Villanova, O dear advocate, fulfill thy office. Since you are Mother of God and advocate of the wretched, assist me who am so wretched. If you do not assist me, I am lost. So let us now address her together in the words of Saint Bernard. Remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, that never was it known that anyone who fled to thy protection, implored thy help, or sought thy intercession, was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I apply unto thee, O Virgin of Virgins, my Mother. To thee do I come, before thee I stand, sinful and sorrowful. O Mother of the Word Incarnate, despise not my petitions, but in thy mercy hear and answer me. Amen. Our Lady, Mediatrix of Sinners,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit,
amen.